Hello friends, I welcome you all for this webinar on behalf of the Busworld Foundation. Busworld has organized a series of global webinars during the last 2 months. We have now decided to organize another series of webinars to address the issues of public transport and bus industry in India during this pandemic. This Busworld webinar is the first of this series. I welcome you all to this webinar on resuming bus manufacturing and on-the-road operations during and after the lockdown. As the economy is gradually being opened up and the restrictions are eased at the beginning of this month during Unlock 1, the OEMs have to restart the manufacturing operations. The bus operators in some cities and some states have started their operations gradually. In this webinar, we shall be discussing the key issues relating to lack of demand, labor shortage, high fixed costs, low capacity utilization, challenges of social distancing impacting both manufacturing activities and transport operations, and multiple curves by local administrations being faced both by the leaders of OEM and bus operators. The key question is as to when the manufacturing activity by the OEMs and bus operators will reach at pre-COVID levels. This whole series of webinars has been planned in partnership with the United Nations Center for Regional Development and UN Habitat Nairobi. The webinars are also being actively participated by members of the Association of State Road Transport Undertakings, as well as bus operators, Confederation of India, and are equally supported by government organizations at different levels. We have got a very distinguished panel of experts from the industry as well as the international institutions. At the very beginning, I would like to invite Mr. Chaudhary Rudracharan Mohanty of UNCRD. A few words of introduction. Mr. Mohanty has been working with the United Nations system for nearly 3 decades. Since 2003, he is working as the Environment Program Coordinator at United Nations Center for Regional Development in Japan under the UN DESA, New York. UNCRD, under the leadership of Mr. Mohanty, organizes every year a regional conference for the promotion of environmentally sustainable transport in Asia and the Pacific, besides several other flagship programs. As a partner organization with the Busworld for this series of webinars, which shall be concluding in the month of October in Bengaluru, where a 3-day conference will be organized on promoting excellence in public transport for safe, smart, and sustainable passenger mobility in India from 6 to 8 October 2020. I feel honored to invite Mr. Mohanty for his opening remarks for flagging this series of webinars.
Thank you, Dr. Singh. Thank you for your kind introduction. Distinguished participants, panelists, and resource persons, on the outset, please allow me on behalf of UNCRD and DESA to express my deep appreciation to the Busworld to organize this series of webinars that leading to the Busworld, the main conference in Bangalore in October 2020. This conference means a lot to us where we are leading the, I think as Dr. Singh mentioned, the regional EST forum in Asia Pacific. And these are really significant input to the process that we are leading in the Pacific. And I will congratulate Busworld to come up with this series of webinars. I think as we all know, that transport contributes to more than a dozen of sustainable development goals, directly or indirectly. Similarly, the bus transportation system has potential to contribute also to many of the SDGs by providing accessibility and also the connectivity, regional connectivity, city to city connectivity, the rural urban connectivity, many form of connectivity to the essential utilities for the all sections of the society. I think all of us know that accessibility is central to achieving sustainable development, achieving all the SDGs. But let us get back to India. In India, the share of buses in the total vehicles population is very low. I think as of all of us know, the only 0.8%, and only 14 private buses per roughly 1 lakh population, and generally operated as intercity routes and also the profitable urban routes. Fleet strength of public owned buses is very small, only 10% of the total number of buses in India. Therefore, there is a need of more than 2 lakh buses to meet the growing demand in the urban sector, as well as to meet the growing demand with regard to the rural urban connectivity. The connectivity is also very important, the rural urban connectivity, in the context of achieving the food security, because we need to provide access to our farmers, better access and better supply chain logistics to the farmer who are actually, you know, producing the crops and ultimately bringing the crops to the urban dwellers. In this situation, the public transportation is global, you know, greatly affected due to this COVID-19 pandemic, unfortunately. And during COVID-19, the zero resources by the operators, revenues by the operators, and the zero sales by the bus manufacturers in the month of April specifically, have not only caused economic turmoil, what Dr. Singh was mentioning, and also it also affected the livelihood security of a large section of the society, millions of people. And for advancing public transport, operators have taken several measures for protecting their staff as well as the passengers. I think we should be thankful to all the bus operators in this crucial time. For effectively resuming the public transportation system, there is an absolute need to restore the public trust. So that is most important. So people, we need to create trust among the public. And I have a number of recommendations here to make it in my opening statement. We need to think of stringent measures for sanitizing, the first and foremost importance, and the regulations for using the masks. And we need to also avoid the crowding or the concentration of people, say, for example, at a single point, such as the waiting places like ticket counters. And we need to go 100% online purchase of the ticket so that we can prevent any concentration. I'm talking about this post-COVID-19 measures. Government should also consider financial and institutional support through tax exemptions, financial incentives, and also rescheduling the debts of the bus manufacturers or the operators. We need to also think of the provision of support for the drivers and other staffs for their basic needs, including secure parking, water, fuel, bathing facilities, and also their shelter. These are crucial to ensure the sustainability of the bus system. And post COVID-19, the bus manufacturers could consider modifying the design of the buses also. I think we have learned a lot of lessons in this COVID-19 pandemic. We need to ensure that our buses are properly designed to equip certain medical facilities, such as artificial, you know, the defibrillators, the transparent separators between the drivers and the operators, and so many other things that is essential to cope up with this type of situation. We need to also think of maximizing the efficiency of the bus operations through the deployment of modern IT tools, such as the intelligent transport system and the traffic management system, because to face, to cope up with this type of situation, I think we need to integrate these modern IT tools in our public transportation system. For governments, operators, and the manufacturers, they enforce and compliance the safety rules and regulations. It is not only health, also the safety rules and regulations as per the WHO, World Health Organization guidelines. And finally, all the stakeholders, the transport stakeholders, should put considerable and effective measures to make the public transport system resilient to cope up with any such future pandemic. So when I say the resilience, I think we need to think of instituting a science policy business interface to set in motion an effective triangular cooperation between the governments, the and the research and scientific organizations, so that our every decision-making process in the transport sector, whether it is a bus system, whether it is a rail system, whether any form of transport and system, we need to take the sound decision to make our public transport and system resilient. Resilience will be extremely important. So now we are talking about COVID-19. It is not only the disease, emergence of disease, and also in the extreme climate events, including the frequency and including the natural disaster time, we need to see that our transportation system is resilient. Because we know that because of climatic impact, the magnitude and frequency of natural disasters are also increasing. So the bus manufacturers to think of the appropriate design, the operators need to think of appropriate management system so that people have better accessibility, efficient accessibility, and people mobility are also sustainable and safe, affordable, and sustainable. So I would conclude my brief opening remarks here, Dr. Singh, and I would like to congratulate once again all the panelists and the organizer. I wish we should have a very fruitful discussion that would feed into our next, not only the conference in Bangalore, also the next regional ESG forum that will be hosted jointly with the UNSCAP, United Nations Economic and Social Commission in Bangkok in November 2020 this year. Thank you so much, Dr. Singh.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mohanty. I think the highlight, what you said, was to build resilience, which is very important for the transport system. And I think there is a lot of learning from the COVID-19 that I think both the manufacturers, as well as I would say that the operators will be doing. Maybe they have to recalibrate the entire system so that, you know, they are able to meet the new challenges. In the interest of time, I would now like to invite our first panelist, Mr. Shivayogi Kalasad of the Indian Administrative Service. Mr. Shivayogi is a senior civil servant and is currently the managing director of Karnataka State Road Transport Corporation, the pioneer road transport corporation in India, and was serving 3 million commuters during the pre-COVID period with 8,700 buses in rural and urban areas and earning daily revenue of rupees 90 million. During the current lockdown 4.0, or say unlock 1, Karnataka has allowed intrastate bus service with some conditions to run the buses for limited time during the day and restrictions of the number of passengers in each bus. I would like to invite Honorable Mr. Shivayogi for his presentation. The key question that remains is as to when can KSRTC reach at the pre-COVID levels in terms of its operations and revenues, and then also move to new heights to support the economy of the state and the country, which is already getting depressed further. Mr. Shivayogi.
Namaskar. Good morning, Dr. Singh. And good morning, my co-panelists. I represent Karnataka State Road Transport Corporation, KSRTC for short. This is one of the premier public sector STUs, as Dr. Singh has already given in his opening remarks. I was impressed with Mr. Mohanty's initial remarks, wherein he stressed upon the transport sector to be resilient. And that was also stressed by Dr. Singh also. Being in the transport sector, we are not just the operators, but are also, we are in the manufacturing business as well. KSRTC, to give a short brief, has a fleet strength of around 8,500 buses with around 32,000 employee strength. But we also have our sister concerns within Karnataka state, like BMTC in Bengaluru, NWRTC in Hubballi and any RTC in Kalaburgi. Together, we constitute a fleet strength of around 23,000 buses with an employee strength of around 1.32 lakh. We have a fairly good employee bus ratio of 4.9, and we were one of the leading STUs in terms of operational efficiency across the various parameters. Be that as it may be, the pandemic has made us a lot more inward looking. We had challenges before the pandemic broke out. We had and we continue to have the challenges during the pandemic, and we also look forward to facing the further challenges during the post-pandemic after the lockdown has been lifted. Friends, mobility, as everybody knows, is the key element in the lives of human beings, not only for the work and social, but also for touring purposes, education purpose, etc. The buses and coaches are all very important means of providing such a mobility to all the categories of classes of people. And the STUs here play a very vital role in providing an affordable, a safe, economical, efficient transport services to the traveling public. Buses and coaches account for a less than 1% of share of the total vehicles across the country. India being the second largest producer of buses across the globe, the market provides a count of just 1.5 buses per 1,000 people. Around 44,000 buses were manufactured in India in the last year. Bus sales, however, declined in the year 2019. I'll come to the various challenges a bit later. I'm just giving the overview point of view. Karnataka KSRTC being a prominent and one of the efficiently run STU, we also have a manufacturing unit in our own state. We have around official buses are being built in the regional workshops. 500 buses are built every year with an additional capacity of another 500 buses being manufactured through a contract labor. We do our induction program based on the requirement of the buses across the sector. But the pandemic has, as I have already mentioned, given us a lot of challenges to ponder about. The challenges pertain to the operational challenges, the financial challenges. We do have challenges of a crew management, the challenges of a fleet management, and also the issues of health and hygiene, etc. So these are the issues which I think I'm sure the panelists will discuss in a greater detail. I would just like to take my presentation in some of the few slides, what the KSRTC has done in the times in the last 40-50 days ago. Let me begin with my mobility challenges in the hours of this particular crisis. Yes, please. Can you just roll down the slide? The major challenge was how to ensure that the fleet was maintained in a very, very hygienic manner. The whole issue of sanitization, the cleaning of the bus stations, the cleaning of the buses, and all the high touch points was a major issue. The public had to be given a lot of hope and confidence that these public buses are safe way of traveling. And this we had to do by way of engaging our own crew members, by engaging the traveling public, and ensuring that all the stakeholders are involved in this particular crisis management. Next slide, please. Can you, yes. We also ensure that our crew members were appropriately and adequately protected. They were, of course, given the sanitization equipment, the gloves, and the masks, which were now have been made all mandatory. We also looked inwards. We started developing and stitching our own masks within our own workshops. So you can say that we did the self-service in terms of giving all the necessary equipment locally. The crew were also given PPE equipment whenever they were dealing with high risk positive patients, etc., to move from COVID hospital to elsewhere, etc. So these kind of initiatives were taken. And I must say that this has been very well received by the public. Next slide, please. The passenger safety was kept in mind. The mobile fever clinics were operated by making use of our own old buses, by converting our own old buses. We have around 20 such buses which are moving around the city of Bengaluru as well as the different mofussil towns of the state. They have come in a very much handy by providing a last mile connectivity in giving the tests, where the results of these tests are really helpful in trying to contain this pandemic to a manageable level. The thermal scan check of the passengers, the display of awareness programs on the message of the bus tickets, and adequate and timely dissemination of information and enforcing the social distancing norms was a real challenge. We have a huge security personnel. We have involved such security person in uniform. We have created a kind of awareness to ensure that not more than 30 people are there in a particular bus. And even in the queue system has been arranged in a proper manner. I'm sure you'll be seeing this in most of our other bus stands as well. Next, please. You can see that even our people representatives and the Honorable Chief Minister involving himself in this kind of dissemination of information and infusing a kind of public confidence, saying that these public buses are useful and quite safe. And a couple of slides wherein the mobile fever clinics have been made for the dedicated public as well as the health personnel in our state. Next slide, please. The greatest challenge, as everyone knows, in the last 45 days has been the issue of migrant labors. The entire country, on the one hand, was faced with the task of minimizing the risk of spreading this particular virus. But on the other hand, we also had the huge humanitarian problem of the migrants walking across the country on road, on rail tracks. That was creating a huge problem for the entire machinery of the government. The courts have also come in giving the directions to the various governments. And we in the government have ensured that a free bus service was given to the migrant laborers moving across the state. And also we have helped the migrant laborers to reach a particular railway station so that they could catch the Shramik trains across the entire country. As of now, our own KSRTC and other sister concerns in our state, we have already helped around 5 lakh people, including the migrant laborers who have gone across the states. At least another 5 lakh people are yet to be shifted, but the demand is coming down since the major Shramik trains are already running on demand. So we felt that this was our basic duty to help the migrant laborers. And even the migrant laborers were given the necessary equipments, the sanitizers, the masks, etc., to ensure that they also act like our ambassadors for ensuring that this pandemic can be regulated and controlled, provided they follow all the health protocols. The media management was very important. We had to convince our public through the media, both print as well as the visual media, through press conferences, to ensure that the right kind of information was disseminated to the traveling public. Next, please. Next slide. The major challenge obviously would be the financial crisis, the previous slide. After the operation crisis, I think the major crisis obviously has to be a financial crisis. With all this, our normal operations would have had a load factor of around 70%. Assuming the total ridership of 30 lakh per day, 3 million passengers per day. But with the pandemic looming large over the heads and with the kind of fear psychosis, we had obviously to, for the last 2 months, we had to shut down our bus operation based on the MHA guidelines. Now with the post-lockdown lifting strategy, slowly and slowly, we have come out with introduction of a few schedules. In the first week, we started with around 1,000 buses. The second week, we started with additional 1,000 buses. Right now, we are operating with around 3,500 buses so that the kind of inducement of bus services also brings in some kind of a confidence to the traveling public. But this comes with a cost. The financial cost of running these buses actually is more than ensuring that the buses are in the depots. But we are in a social service of providing the transport services. That's the reason why we are facing all the more financial distress. So how do we come out of this? Fortunately, the state government of Karnataka has given a lending hand. They have supported us in giving the salary support for the last 1 month. Even yesterday, we had had discussion with the Honorable Chief Minister. He has assured us that even for the month of May and probably the ensuing months also, we'll definitely get some kind of a support. But it's not just the salary alone. The fixed cost will continue to be a major concern. The variable cost also keeps on changing based on the number of schedules we keep operating. The cost of the HST, which was the minimum about 3 weeks ago, has again started to go up. And these are the issues which we normally face. So we have requested the government of India to come to our help to ensure that at least the motor vehicle tax, the toll gate tax, and other such statutory taxes are at least deferred for about 2 quarters to ensure that we at least come back on the track to recovery trajectory. And some of the other HR measures which we thought will bring in some kind of a financial discipline include to curtail the use of the overtime facilities, to curtail all other non-essential expenditure to the minimum. The outsourced staff may have to be redeployed. The restructuring of our organization was definitely required, and we are trying to do our best in minimizing the cost, etc. The next slide, please. The safety measures, which is now almost like a norm now, the sanitization part of it, the sanitizing the electronic ticketing machines basically, and also to ensure that the boarding of buses and the capacity within the buses is properly maintained to ensure that social distancing norms are taken care of. Obviously, the standing passengers will not be allowed. The linen, bedspread, etc., may have to be removed for the time being, at least till things come to a normal thing. The reservation system, advanced reservation system, will be properly encouraged, and also the digital transactions of buying the tickets online mode will definitely be stressed upon to ensure that the physical contact of any touch points is minimized to a large extent. Some of these are the major safety measures which will definitely take a long way to ensure that we bring the confidence back to the traveling public, please. Next one. Next slide. Yeah, of course, there are some of the other initiatives which we have taken, like staggering of our operations. Some of the initiatives which you must have seen, that the STUs are also thinking of renting out some of the buses to various other contract carrier systems, to the hospitals, to the educational institutions, to any such organization which may make use of these kind of buses. The use of air-conditioned buses, we have around 20% of our fleet strength being air-conditioned, especially for long-distance buses. Volvo, Tata, these are the companies which have really have had a long relationship with the KSRTC, and we have had a very good fleet and maintenance protocol for resuming the operation of the air-conditioned buses also. The challenges of the mechanical, the challenges of the land issues, all these are the ones which probably will be put to task once we start resuming them. We in the Karnataka state have already opened up to a large extent. Our government in the state of Karnataka has already opened up across the state in the state level, but also we are looking to have operations interstate also to the neighboring states. It is again subject to the consent being given by the other states as well. We hope to ensure a proper resumption of services to at least 50% in the next maybe 4 to 6 weeks of time, and probably to ensure that we resume to pre-COVID levels maybe by 4 months to 6 months of time. This is a very optimistic view which we in the transport sector hold on to this particular thing. My friends, as other panelists also would have to realize that the challenges are not just restricted to the operational part of it. The production of the buses to and transition to the BS6 model, from BS4 to BS6 model, this is another challenge probably which we'll have to face, and that is the bigger challenge which we'll have to face in the times to come. The labor crisis, which Dr. Singh was mentioning, we in the state of Karnataka have a huge IT labor. Fortunately, the IT is located in the Bangalore, but we also have some of the non-skilled, unskilled labor who have migrated across the state as well as to the northern part of the country. That will be another issue while building our buses or manufacturing, etc. All in all, I say the industry being very labor intensive, maintaining social distance could be a challenge in the times to come, but we had to be optimistic. I must say that being optimistic in these times of challenges will bring in the real character, and the public transport has always proved. Pandemic of this nature was once in a century, once in a lifetime. But I think the future holds good. I'm optimistic that in the times to come, collectively, we should face this particular pandemic and come out with workable solutions. And that is what one of the ideas of the bus world also is, to bring about this kind of engagement with the experts and in the field to ensure that we are right on the track. Being in Bangalore, I take this as an opportunity to congratulate and thank Dr. Singh and to organize this kind of facilities, as well as to ensure that we are the also partnering for hosting this Bus World program way ahead in the month of October here in Bangalore, where we can see the further interaction of manufacturers, operators, suppliers, and also the traveling public. I would like to end my small presentation. Maybe we can run a video for about 2 minutes. It is basically a resemblance of the activities which we have already taken in the same last 2 months, etc. I would again thank and wish the sector all the very best. Thank you, Dr. Singh.
Can we defer it the video, which we can show it later? In the, again, interest of time, I would like to invite Mr. Suresh Chettiar, Business Head, Volvo Buses, South Asia. Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Shivayogi, for the wonderful presentation. Basically, KSRTC is doing wonderful work in the operational preparedness and also for protecting the employees and all others. We do know that there are challenges, financial challenges, where you are getting some help from the state government. But hopefully, I think as soon as the operations become normal, perhaps you will be able to cope it up much better. May I now invite Mr. Suresh Chettiar, Business Head, Volvo Buses, South Asia. Mr. Suresh Chettiar is a very brilliant mechanical engineer with over two decades of experiences at Volvo Bus and Volvo Group. He has held senior leadership roles across functions and businesses. Apart from driving market development of Volvo's high-end buses in India, also successfully launched UD branded buses to herald Volvo's entry into the value segment of buses. Kindly share your views on the current status of the industry and how it is going to resume the activities and reach the pre-COVID levels, particularly when the economy is facing the challenge of a steep fall in the GDP in the current year, and we are now moving to BS6 standards. Mr. Chettiar.
All right, thank you very much. Sorry, there was a bit of a challenge. I did not know exactly why. But let me start now without losing much time. Thank you, Dr. Singh, also for your kind words and having me on this platform today. Many compliments for you and the Busworld Academy to be able to organize these series of webinars. I think this will go a long way to get the industry view coming together and at the same time find credible ways of moving forward in the collective good of each of the stakeholders in this enormous bus industry. As we know, during this period, the social and economic activities as is impacting each one of us have come to a halt. And with this unlocking of the lockdown, we do see that there is a ray of hope if we are able to collectively put the right kind of measures in place. But we cannot ignore the fact that both the bus and the coach industry and each and every stakeholder connected with it, with this has had a severe impact, to say the least. We now also have a good understanding of the consequences, especially on the bus operators. And I would like to hear mention a bit more on the private segment, which has been impacted quite severely as the revenues have dried up during the peak season months. And even as the lockdown will now open up, getting businesses back on the track will be a key challenge because employees and workforces, many of them will find it difficult to get back to work, especially the ones who've kind of returned back to their hometowns. And then when it comes to bus manufacturers, Volvo is a bus company here in India, and then companies similar to us will have very, very distinct challenges, especially given the high level of investments and fixed costs that we carry. And at the same time, the extra burden of investments we have recently put in place also for the BS6 changeover for our products. Having said that, it is very crucial to find a way to move forward. Can you please move the slide to the next one?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
All right. It will be important to move forward in a way that we are able to provide the right kind of confidence for all our passengers who will take to buses, and at the same time, the authorities to ensure that this industry is continuing to move forward. As an overall ecosystem, I have put some of them on the word cloud on the left-hand side, but the main thing is every element of this ecosystem has been impacted. And at the same time, the level of impact is in a way measured by the overall level of public transport movement that we take in India. Roughly over 80% of all people trips that are taken in this country are actually taken by buses. and that will also include the rail as well as air. And that gives an indication of the level of employment that this sector has generated, the level of economic activity that it supports, and also the level of personal and social engagement this segment is able to drive for the people of the country. As we move into the new normal, we will have a very, very distinct change of set of change dynamics, and that also will provide some opportunities for us as a segment to work upon. As we already heard from Mr. Kalasad, going forward, the number of passengers in a bus is likely to be low, at least in the initial months, and that puts a very different kind of burden on the cost. I have also kind of, being as part of the bus industry, tracked over a period of time how the different cost levels and revenue streams have moved over the last, let's say, 6 to 10 years. One of the challenges this segment have always faced is that given the high intensive competition that we have, revenues have normally not been able to catch up with the cost levels. And most of our bus operators and therefore operate at very, very thin margins. But this is one of the times where when we come out of this deep crisis and start to operate buses, there must be a catch up in terms of how revenues can balance with the cost. It is also important to do that because the expectations from the passenger segments on our business will now be completely different, because they are looking, in addition to mobility needs, also as semblance of confidence from a health and safety perspective. As an industry, I think it is quite important for us to be able to raise the bar and deliver on that expectation and inspire confidence for the public. One of the things that we have kind of seen in the narrative during the lockdown phase was that given social distancing expectations, that public transport can probably wait for some time. And I think this has been largely because of immediate reactions to the situation and not probably thought through in a great detail. When we look at the amount of dependency that public transport serves, it is important to also realize that very little can be done by finding personal vehicles as an alternative choice. Let's take, for example, the several precautions that we have seen that KSRTC Managing Director just enumerated, and most of us are now wanting to follow them. Very little of it is possible to very institutionally be deployed when it comes to private vehicle or personal vehicle operations, whether it is two-wheelers, cars, and then when it comes to organized public transport and like the one that KSRTC has demonstrated, for example, it is so much more possible to bring in investments, bring in standard operating procedures, and also right kind of guidance for people to follow, just so that the transmission risk with the virus is so much more minimized in public transport. And that is, I think, one of the biggest opportunities and expectations that this industry needs to deliver. And I think then, therefore, buses can become actually the carrier of the economic activity as we move forward. Can we take the next slide, please? When it comes to the factory operations and Volvo Bus India as a company, we were fortunate to pick up early orders for our BS6 products also during the pre-COVID situation in March. And therefore, we were able to get back into production as the lockdown opened up during the month of May. What we have done is that we have followed very, very strict adherence to high-level protocols that we developed based on guidelines from different health agencies and technical agencies, and we have implemented them very, very strictly in our factory premises. We've also, wherever it was required because of the social distancing norm, changed our working routines and worked with a very, very graded ramp-up to ensure that there are no risks undertaken as we have progress with our industrial activity. In addition to people, the incoming material also has been quite well detailed in terms of the sanitization and related work that needs to be done to create a factory environment which is contamination free when it comes to the virus. The challenge that we will see forward, going forward, will be mainly on the supply chain, largely because several cities still are continuing to be under the lockdown, and components and parts which are kind of mainly tier 2 and tier 3 suppliers stuck in these lockdown cities might pose challenges for the supply chain. And we will also see as workmen find it difficult to get back into factories. So what we are doing now is that over the next few weeks, we will kind of attend to each of these issues and ensure that there are ways found out to be able to seamlessly continue production in anticipation of a new normal. While we do that, one of the key challenges will be to see the demand side recovery. There is no denying the fact that in the short term, this will be a very, very difficult situation. But based on the connect that we have with our market in India, we do see that quarter three and quarter four during this year will see spurt of activity. And I think I would also like to kind of mention here a couple of things. Like, for example, bus operators, both STUs as well as private operators. The bus manufacturing organizations are also a very, very important part of this value chain. Taking our example, we are in many ways the finest bus facility that is there in the country. And in order to sustain and be able to kind of provide continued services, the government must find ways to ensure that the lockdown opens up almost near to complete for long distance as well as city bus movements. And then business starts to come back into each of the stakeholders, including the bus companies. Please take the next slide. So during this period of the lockdown, I think one of the key aspects that I would also like to share here now is that Volvo buses were very much involved to the extent possible in moving people for several segments, including airport transfer, moving stranded passengers, and also in many, many cases, movement of foreigners, mainly tourists and embassy officials from across the country. And we have seen that these movements were done very, very well by the respective operators. And actually, one of the findings is that the bus itself is not providing an element of risk when it comes to the pandemic spread. And this is where I want to mention also is that public transport, also with buses as any other public transport, must be seen as an extension of any other public spaces. What we need to do is to provide for the bus itself is not the challenge. And I think that is a very, very important message, not only to be allowed by authorities, but at the same time to be used by all of us in our communications. With the unlock one, we have now seen interstate services opening up in some selected areas, and we will see during this month many more states opening up. But already city bus operations have started in many cities. Volvo buses now are running, run by BMTC, operating almost 85 buses now within Bangalore. Then similarly, buses are operating in Andhra Pradesh, West Bengal, Assam, and some other parts, including Punjab. Another key message that I wanted to share now is that rather quickly we have seen globally many companies or many cities going in for additional bus purchases. For example, in Brussels, the city has already placed an order now during May and actually in the last part of May to order for 128 hybrid buses. Similarly, bus orders have been coming in from Latin America for BRT, some city in Sweden, and several other places. This is a very, very clear indication that bus, specifically including AC buses, are not seen as a risk. It is just that we have to move forward with the needed precautions that need to be taken. On our side, we have been working quite deeply to understand the recommendations coming in from various health agencies, including WHO, various technical agencies, including the ones giving guidance on air conditioning and refrigeration, and also the medical fraternity. Based on all of these inputs, we have developed several advisories for the benefit of our customers and as well as the passengers. These advisories are hosted quite regularly on our social media websites to be taken advantage of. And at Volvo, as mentioned by a couple of other speakers, what we are doing is to build a host of feature levels and adapt several medical innovations on our products to be able to kind of give that extra element of confidence to our customers and passengers. Next slide, please. So finally, on the way forward, we recognize that bus operations are very much integral and actually important to sustain the economic activity. And all of these stakeholders must do our best to ensure that we are able to start operations, but in a way that we can sustain them and not have risk as we go around. So all the operators should come together and ensure that our passengers feel safe, that the standard operating procedures are followed, and there is no added element of risk by taking a public transport by bus. Then coming back to the areas that government can support, I think there is definitely plenty of areas that government needs to bring in their intervention. One of them, I think, standing out is the support that our bus operators need. STUs definitely have support to some extent from respective state governments, but I think in these times, what is missing in is the support for private bus operators. And this has been a very, very entrepreneurial and highly energized set of operators that we have across India who have stood by the country in all the difficult times, and they are now looking out for support. And here it could be mainly in the areas of financial support. But at the same time, it is important to do this and sustain development in the areas of capacity augmentation, because as one of the speakers mentioned, that we have already a big gap in the number of buses needed to meet the needs of public transport today in India. Last few years, we've had, for several reasons, mainly connected to the economy, is also the financial system. The progress in terms of addition of new buses have actually kind of lacked, and that builds up a lot of pent-up demand. And I think there is an opportunity now with government intervention to kind of bring even more improved products on the market. Government has released a substantial amount of money as stimulus in various areas, and I think some of those areas can be of benefit to operators as SMEs as well. But one of the things that we have seen missing, and I think we must push for that, is stimulus package towards providing for asset creation and asset creation for developing new transport infrastructure. We have seen a lot of effort from the government side in developing airports and airlines infrastructure. We have seen that happening in the railways, but buses still remain one of the last reached out areas when it comes to providing support for transport infrastructure, and that must be provided, because therefore that can provide access to low cost financing, and also bringing in technology to be able to provide a seamless integrated multimodal transport with buses. If you see, largely bus industry is today left on its own, and that message goes very clearly down to the passengers who must feel much more confident with the added level of investment that government should provide in order to compare well with what is provided for airlines and railways. And one very, very good possibility there exists by bringing private players into this through PPP partnership. Next, I think going forward, both private operators and STUs can find a way to collaborate much better, because so far there has been understanding and sympathies on both sides, but at the same time the competition has been quite severe. But there is this opportunity to see that collective knowledge that is available with such a large set of players, both on private as well as STUs, should be leveraged to ensure that this industry is sustained quite well. And the last point from my side would be, as Volvo Buses, I think I want to share that we are taking the next steps to build buses with quite a set of advanced feature levels to ensure that both health and safety is very well addressed. and people can then feel very safe to travel in these buses. And we will be releasing these specifications and several marketing material in the coming weeks. I'm also happy to say that the first prototype is already near completion, and this could go a long way in giving the country a very, very good level of confidence to move on with public transport in buses. So that's all from my side. Thank you. And I'm sorry for the initial glitch in terms of the audio sharing. Okay.
Thank you very much, Mr. Suresh. I think time management is an issue for the moderator, basically, because more or less now we are starting the second webinar, because the first webinar's time is nearly over and we still have three speakers. Anyway, I think you have given a ray of hope, basically, because public transport can certainly deliver an assurance of safe travel. And that's what, as a matter of fact, we would like to ensure. There are so many questions which are there, but I think what we will be doing is we'll be sharing those questions. They are questions addressed to you. They are questions addressed to Mr. Shivayogi also. And perhaps there'll be other questions which we'll be sharing with you later on, with the request that you can kindly respond to those questions in writing. And then we will share with all the attendees. May I now take the opportunity inviting Ms. Nupur Gupta. Ms. Nupur Gupta is an economist and senior transport specialist from Harvard University with the World Bank since 2005. And she is working in the South Asia region. She has been working extensively on urban transport engagements of the World Bank in India and other South Asian countries under the Sustainable Urban Transport Program, Efficient and Sustainable City Bus Services Project, and Clean Area and Sustainable Environment Project involving capacity building and investment in BRT systems, and many such initiatives of the bank. My request is if we can kindly shorten the presentation and give clear messages, that will really be excellent. We have already exceeded our time limit. Thank you very much and welcome, Nupur.
Thank you so much. A very good morning to everyone. I want to thank especially Busworld and UNCRD for organizing this timely webinar on such a burning topic. Thank you for inviting me to talk on this important subject. Let me, without much ado, get started with the presentation as the clock is ticking. Sonam, can you please put up the presentation?
Yes, sharing it.
So as we all know, we are, I think, largely from the bus transport fraternity. This is COVID times. But even before COVID times, can we go to the next slide, please? I just want to clarify that my presentation is focused on the city bus and the urban bus sector, essentially. So please view messages, etc., from that lens, although they largely apply to the overall bus sector in general as well. Yeah. So I think even before the current pandemic and the catastrophic impact that it has had on all walks of life and businesses, let's accept that the urban bus sector was in distress even before the pandemic, right? There, as various speakers have highlighted, there's a huge supply gap, and we estimate it to be, that maybe a tripling or quadrupling of the bus numbers is really required to come to some reasonable levels, not even internationally recognized levels of 100 buses per lakh population, as in London or Singapore, etc. There is, the quality of service being provided is poor. There is aging and stagnant fleet. you hardly see any growth in this sector. And by and large, most of the operators, whether in the public space or private space, are not doing that well financially, right? It's really in survival mode. A large part of the problem really comes from the fact that the policy environment is not really conducive, right? What I mean by that is there's not a clear mandate for the provision of public transport as we see elsewhere. You know, no one questions why public transport is mandatory and should be provided in cities and to the citizens at large. Whereas here, it's up to the whims of the officers or the state dispensation, right? So there needs to be much more clarity on the overall dispensation, on the importance of public transport, and that it must be recognized as something which must be provided and those are things that must be decided. What level of service, right? At which level, size of city? A lot of things which can be clarified so that there is not that ambiguity that continues. The second big issue is that it's so underfunded. Because there is not a clarity on the importance of the sector and that it must be provided, there are not clear long-term funding mechanisms available for this. Thirdly, you find that it is not very modern, the sector, for obvious reasons, because it's underfunded. Most of the operators and operations have not adopted what internationally would be considered basic modern techniques, right? Such as intelligent transport systems, etc., which can really considerably improve efficiency levels, can improve the user orientation in the way services are deployed. And finally, you know, bringing back that performance focus to say, you know, that we will perform as per certain KPIs. That needs to be grounded, whether in the public sector or in the private sector, right? I mean, if we are going to talk about a scale up of 3 to 4 times, then we really need perhaps to harness the private sector into contracting these operations. That's the only way that scale up will come. And with that will come also a lot more efficiencies. But even if we want to use, you know, public operations, they must be on an arm's length basis with clear KPIs. Next slide, please. So that was before the pandemic, right? With the pandemic, we actually have a situation of acute distress now. Why? Because, you know, now, not only are the usual issues there, but also we are faced with this huge loss in revenue, in having to implement social distancing, in having to adopt sanitation and hygiene protocols, which come at a cost at the end of the day, right? Next slide, please. And so worldwide, and the red is really, you know, the India public transport usage trends, right? Worldwide, public transport usage dropped by almost 80 to 100% during the lockdown. And what we are now beginning to see a very slow revival, right? Next slide. And what you see as global trends is that, you know, cities in China, for example, Shenzhen, next slide, please, or even Beijing, public transport recovery by the end of the first month was only to the extent of 30, 35%. Next slide, please. And in fact, the recovery in the use of cars or personal modes, and even bicycles for that matter, was up to the extent of 70%, which suggests that, you know, public transport was not, the recovery was slow because there was this huge concern around, the safety aspects and the likelihood of contracting COVID in crowded public transport environments. Next slide, please. And so if you just look at these three distinct phases, right? The lockdown, where you see a complete erosion of passenger base, huge losses for the operators because the revenue completely erodes, but also there are fixed costs where salaries have to be paid, etc., etc., right? And then we move to the recovery phase, where which is what we are getting into now, post-lockdown, where you start seeing a gradual recovery to 40 or 70% of the passenger levels. But it comes with a huge phobia and concern about the safety of public transport. And at the same time, there is a growing preference for individual or personal modes of transport because they are obviously seen as being safe. So anyone who can afford or owns personal modes would prefer to begin to use them. And that's not really a healthy trend for, by any means, given that our cities, Indian cities, are already congested. But also there is a positive trend in terms of, which probably should be leveraged in Indian cities, is in terms of looking at NMT, which is, you know, walking and cycling, and trying to promote that as an option going forward. But, you know, remember, in the recovery phase two, we are looking at huge losses for the operators, continuing over perhaps, you know, at least for the next 3 to 6 months. And then, you know, we have to transition to a new normal. Everyone talks of the new normal, right? Things will never be the same again. But if things will never be the same again, what is our collective vision for a more resilient, safer, and more attractive public transport system, right? And there are expectations. I think Mr. Chettiar very nicely outlined those, that people will expect something better downstream. And it is for, you know, the policymakers, the bus fraternity, to, you know, think collectively, what is that vision, and can we course correct, use this crisis situation to start moving to a better vision, which means certainly many more buses, better quality of service, right? All in all, we move towards greener modes, we move towards digitization, which means we leverage technology far more effectively than we have in our operations, in handling customers, in ticketing, in all of those aspects. All of this will certainly mean higher costs if we want a better quality of something. And it must come with more resources being given to the sector, right? And really, there is a need to start thinking around those imperatives. So it's all about keeping the cities moving, right? Mr. Chettiar talked about economic recovery, how important the bus sector is to that revival of the economy. And I will reiterate that because, you know, this is perhaps an extremely important point. If our cities are to remain competitive, right? I mean, everyone, the whole economy has taken a huge hit at this time. And it's important that that recovery process starts soon, right? But if our cities cannot move people efficiently, that recovery is hugely compromised and jeopardized. We must make sure that public transport systems, which are the lifelines of many of these cities, continue to operate and sustain the confidence of users, that things do not start unraveling and we see a inundation of personal modes, we see huge congestion, we see a lot of people stuck because they don't really have any other options, and that would be a very bad situation. So the critical issue is to keep the cities moving in this economic recovery phase that has two very important elements. One is to ensure the safety, so contain the COVID, make sure that your public transport is safe and you're following the standard operating procedures properly. Because if it is not safe and it is seen as a hotspot, then that is where the whole thing falls apart, right? And then the next part pillar of it is how to ensure the solvency of the sector, right? While this is happening, because we know it's bleeding even more than it was bleeding before. Containing COVID, I think everyone's talked about and understands that we must protect the users, the passengers, we must protect the crew. It's absolutely critical to do that. We must communicate to everyone, including users. We must train our staff to tell them what we are doing, how it must be done, how to conduct ourselves in these environments, right? Technology, contactless ticketing, passenger information systems, which can tell you when the next bus is coming, which can tell you how crowded the bus is, whether you will get a seat on it with the social distancing, right? All of these are absolutely important for the safety of both the passenger and the crew, and STUs and SPVs that are ahead of the curve, who have been able to implement ITS systems, will be much better off because they will be able to ensure a safer environment than those that don't. And we must find ways to start deploying those kinds of systems. Social distance, of course, must observe. We know that, you know, and there's a lot of debate where we hear how, and I think, you know, that's going to be, it's something that we must think through, because once we start compromising on the safety elements, it's a very narrow downhill path to disaster. And finally, ensuring survival. Now, you know, we must at the first crack really ensure the liquidity of the system, of the operators, that they can manage to stay afloat, right? But then there are other elements. I mean, I think BOKI and ASRTU, etc. A lot of entities are already dialoguing with the government on these issues. But waiver of taxes, like Mr. Kalsar said, extension of document validity, as Mr. Prasanna Patwardhan keeps talking about, even getting concessional finance. All of this will go a long way. I think the other item which is less talked about is looking at fares. In these crisis times, it's probably, something that we have to consider, because easily available. And we must look at a shared responsibility in terms of sharing of the cost between both the users and public sector. And it's probably, let's not load everything on one or the other. Let's think more pragmatically. And if we can, we can guarantee and assure passengers that this is being done to provide them safety, and that you will ensure their safety by doing this, then perhaps it will go some way in getting somewhere. And then let's look at the efficiency items, right? I mean, digitalization will reap you a lot of efficiency improvements, which can help you cut down your costs. Conductless travel is something else that we must start exploring, right? The AP SRTC is actively pursuing this, and that can really help you reduce costs and also improve the safety of crew and passengers, right? Contracting is the other way that you can reduce costs. And finally, I want to come that, you know, the government must start thinking of long-term funding mechanisms. What is the long-term sustainable funding that we can provide to the bus sector? Because it's not about now in this crisis, but it's in perpetuity. How to sustain this to be a vibrant public transport sector that contributes to the economic development, contributes to livable cities, contributes to the environment. So many pluses that cannot be. Can we go to the next slide, please?
Nupur, can we conclude as early as possible?
Yes, I'm almost done. And can we go to the next slide?
Please.
Yeah, and the next
one.
Yes, thank you. So, basically, you know, I think a little bit of thought on the trade-offs, and, you know, social distancing presents one major trade-off that we must think about, which is public transport on the one hand is the lifeline, is the main way of transporting a large number of passengers, right? some of the metro cities may have a different profile, but we did a survey in 2014 and we found that from the public transport user profile, almost 33 to 35% of the public transport users did not own any vehicle, right? Less than almost 50% had at the household level access to a two-wheeler, right? That does not mean that the public transport user had access to. So, you know, think of the captive users who will not have any options available, and look at the other candidates who will quickly graduate to personal modes, which is not a good thing in any case, right? So with social distancing, we are on the one hand looking at an erosion in your revenues, but then we are also looking at a 50% erosion of capacity. How are we going to manage the commute of the remaining 50%, which we can no longer cater to, right? I mean, that's another issue that we must think about, which, you know, the states and the cities must start thinking about how, and therefore there is a need to deploy as many buses as is possible to try and use a lot of, there are other buses like school buses or contract buses, which are, you know, idle at large periods. Can we deploy those in peak hours? Can we stagger times? We have to be innovative in all of this. And finally, who's going to enforce the social distancing? I think there were a lot of questions about, you know, social distancing and, you know, whether we need to, there will in any case be crowding. How do we manage that? And I think that requires a lot of building, but, you know, crowding will end if we don't have other options available. So deploying as many buses as we can, as quickly as we can, is one option. But we must also look at cycling, etc., like other cities in the world are doing, to offer for the shorter trips for an alternative and safer option, which, you know, historically has never been looked at and frowned upon, but maybe could be something to consider. Let me move to the next slide. So it really brings us back to, Sona, please, the next slide. So we have been advising the Ministry of Road Transport. No, go back to the previous slide, please. Yeah. You know, there has been a discussion. They've been equally concerned about the state of the bus sector. And before the pandemic hit, there has been an active discussion around having a national level bus rejuvenation scheme, right? To move towards a more sustainable new normal for the bus sector, so to speak, right? And the main contours of that scheme really talked about creating a state level mobility strategy, bus transport strategy, which articulated the state's vision and also their mandate to provide public transport in a certain size of cities, so 500,000 plus size cities of a certain level, which means 40 buses per lakh or 50 buses per lakh or 70 buses per lakh, you know. So clear guidance, but supported by funding, which could be shared or whatever, but with guaranteed funding. You know, operationalization of a necessary institutional mechanism which supported this. Today, there is a lot of fragmentation, and that creates that lack of clarity in how to move forward and who's to do what. If those are defining the institutional arrangements, defining the long-term funding arrangements, and how funding will be assigned for such a program to be funded, moving towards a more objective and arm's length KPI related service delivery, which includes contracting private operators to provide efficient and more cost effective services. And finally, all of it backed by technology. So ITS is a fundamental pillar which enables all of this and ensures a much stronger monitoring and delivery of the services than before. So this was the original architecture, but even more so today in our COVID situation, this becomes even more important. And this dialogue continues with the Ministry of Road Transport, MOPUA, and Niti Aayog. There have been a few rounds of discussion, and we are hopeful that if and when such a scheme comes, things will begin to look very different in India in the bus transport sector. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Nupur, I think, for a wonderful presentation. You have talked about the new normal, basically, which, as a matter of fact, does require a lot of changes in our system. And of course, also, above all, it will certainly require not only new technology, but also the financial support that you have highlighted and underscored. I do hope that the Government of India, as well as the state governments, will really have a look at what you are saying as a kind of, rejuvenation of the entire policy in this regard. Thank you so much. I now would like, there are so many questions which are listed in your name, Nupur. I think we will be sharing those questions to you with the request that you can kindly respond to them, and then we'll be sharing with all the attendees for that matter.
Sure, certainly, we'll be happy to.
Yeah. We do have a very, I would say, a special guest, Mr. Yoga Adiwinarto. He is a well-known international expert in the field of BRT system. He is currently the technical and facility director at Transjakarta, a company in Indonesia that runs the longest BRT network in the world. In this position, he is responsible in managing the infrastructure for maintenance and new development, information technology, quality control on the system fleet, as well as the development of electrification of Transjakarta's fleet. All these are important issues confronting the industry in India. As an international expert, we have specially invited him to share with us as to how the public transport system in Indonesia is managing during the pandemic scenario. Mr. Yoga.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Singh. Good morning or good afternoon, everyone. My name is Yoga from Transjakarta, from Indonesia. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Singh and also Busworld Academy for inviting Transjakarta and also myself to speak on this very valuable session. And also to thanks to the Nupur and also previous presenters. I think many of the points that highlighted by Nupur and also the opening remarks by Dr. Mohanty really relates what we are actually experiencing right now and also some of the challenges that we are currently facing. So we're just before I started the presentation, I just want to update that we're still currently on a lockdown in Jakarta, and but the government just mentioned that it will be eased by tomorrow. So we will basically go to the what we call the transition phase. So it's not the new normal, as Nupur mentioned, but what we can actually call it transition. So make sure that people are still ready, people basically still adjusting and everything. But for us, it will be the same as what we call the new normal. I mean, because the passengers and also the mobility are starting to pick up, especially in the last sort of, 3 days. That we see in a lot of mobility increase. Just a brief before I mentioned about the experience, I just want to explain about the Transjakarta. As Dr. Singh already mentioned, the Transjakarta, yes, we basically run the longest bus rapid transit or BRT system in the world, 240 kilometers of the corridor with over 250 routes. So we run not only the BRT, but we also run all sort of services like feeders, and we run all the buses from the 18 meter articulated buses to the sort of like a 6 meters micro buses as a feeder. We have 3,300 fleet in total of the system, but we are also, so we are 100% city owned company. But even with this 100 with the city percent, so 100% of a city owned company, we are basically subsidized about 60% of our revenue. So 60% comes from the government subsidy, and then about 35% comes from the ticket revenue, and then 5% from the other sort of non-fare box revenue. But the issue is that right now, I mean, you know, as the pandemic will be over, but we have, so health crisis might be over, but then the financial crisis is actually waiting for us, and even it's already hit us for now. So some of the changes, next slide, please. So some of the changes that caused by the pandemic, I mean, the first one, obviously similar with the other presenters, is the cost increase and also revenue decline. I mean, this is basically, I think, experienced everywhere in the world. So in our case, the increase of cost per passengers basically increased by 40%, whereas the revenues declined by 50%. So the declining revenue is not only contributed by the ticket cost, by the ticket fare, but also from the subsidy that we receive from the government because of the, you know, the financial situation that the city government currently experience. And also, obviously, the same, like, you know, we're limiting the capacity, so the capacity is decreased by 50%. We have to enforce the, you know, the crowd, so there's a crowd management station, and long queue, obviously, I expect that, especially in the peak hour. And the current changes that we are currently doing is that, this is basically what I try to call the war zone operation model. So normally before COVID, we run all the buses, all the operation based on the headway or sometimes in the timetable. So it's like, you know, one buses every 5 minutes or 10 minutes. But right now, because we're limiting the capacity, so basically once the bus already, you know, reached the 50% capacity, then we deploy them no matter, you know, how long is the corridor. But we still limit, you know, the maximum headway is five minutes during the peak hour. But sometimes we have actually have, you know, two or three buses running at the same time because, you know, so many passengers coming at the same time. And the peak and off-peak management. So before COVID, so between the number of buses operating in peak and off-peak, basically 70% runs on the off-peak hour. But right now we actually have to run 40%. So the peak hour, we have to send, so during the off-peak, we have to send back about 60% of our buses. So not only because the demand is so low, but also to also save costs. So we have to make sure that the peakiest passengers are basically served. And starting on the last week of March, we applied the non-cash policy. So all cash transactions are banned. So basically we only receive the smart card and also no payment and also no top up for the smart card using you know, at the station. So if they want to top up, they have to do it on the outside merchants. And the other changes that also when we face is that we are assigned by the government to help the transport for the healthcare workers. So what we call it, the Transjakarta care. So we basically assist the 8 workers, you know, the COVID-19 nurses and also doctors that living in, you know, the facilities provided by the government. And that has to be, you know, like basically using the very, very carefully health and safety procedures. And we also help the government to, you know, to help the health workers to do the contact tracing, which is also quite difficult because we have to get this, like basically we have to bring the samples and also get the samples, you know, from the patients. Next one, next slide, please. Next slide.
Next slide, please. Sonam.
Right, so just a brief about, you know, some of the health and safety policies and operating procedures. Similar, I think this is pretty much similar with other countries. Sorry, can you go back just one slide? Just want to show some pictures before. The previous slide, please. Slide number 3. All right, okay, let me just stop here then. So basically, yeah, so the previous slide just talked about the health and safety procedures, but this is just, I think this is the important, yeah, all right. Okay, let me just very, very brief explain this. So all the temperature checking, hand sanitizer, we also provide the wash basin at the stations. So as you can see, this is really, really portable and, you know, like pop up. And physical distancing policies. So we basically limit like 1 meter, you know, standing at the stations, as well as, you know, limiting the space for the drivers. So the drivers basically will not be mixed with the other passengers. And also the seat between, like empty seat, between passengers. And also the last one is the bus cleaning. So we do all the cleaning at the station. So every, once they finish the one cycle of every trip, we have bus guard basically, you know, cleaning all the hand grip and also, you know, the seats for passengers. We have to make sure that all the buses are properly disinfected. Next one, please.
Next one, slide.
So, yeah. No. Just
kindly move back. On.
Go back, please. Slide number 4. Yes. So this is basically the important stuff. So just to show that, I mean, we always believe that the supply has to serve demand. But this is basically just a figure of what exactly how the ridership. But this ridership is also not only created by the policies of the government, but also policies by us. So for example, the figure on this, the event on the 16th of March, what we call the trial for surface restriction. So when the first COVID-19 case announced in 2nd of March, the surface basically still running as per normal, but then the government decided on 16th of March, they want to test the trial, you know, what if we limit supply? So Transjakarta, the mass rapid transit, MRT, and also the LRT, all of us basically, you know, at that date, we limited all the supply of the buses and also the train. And also we cut all the services significantly. We announced them 2 days before. There was some chaos, but basically during that day, we managed to bring down the passengers by 25%. So the reason is because the government wanted to stop the mobility. They want to give the message to the passengers and also to public that, you know, with COVID-19 you have to restrict your mobility. But this is more like a trial that we did only one day. That's why the next day when we cancel the trial and also, you know, release the service as per normal, then the number of passengers like cut by half. So this is basically just to send a message to the people that we have to limit the mobility. And then by the 23rd of March, the government decided to really limit all the mobility. So we only run, from 258 routes that we run normally, we had to run only 13 routes on that day until now. So now we run mostly about between 13 to 20 routes, but all on the BRT services, so no feeder services whatsoever. So as you can see, with limiting the limiting the supply, we also get the demand kind of like decrease, and also the mobility of the people basically sort of like a stable at the 10% of the normal movement. And that's kind of like also in line with the other mobility made by the private vehicles as well. So we're still kind of on lockdown, but as you can see, the number, you know, on the last sort of 3 or 4 days, start to gradually increase. And we also anticipate that by the end of, this month, we'll probably anticipate about increase of 30 to 40% of the, from today's number. And that's something that we have to anticipate in the near future. Next one, please. So this is the last slide that I would just want to show you, the current plan that we are currently thinking. So, I mean, obviously immediate plan that we are also already doing now is to prevent COVID-19 spread in public transport. So, the standard operating procedures, all the PPPs and et cetera. So that's basically what we have to do to ensure, the sustainability of the surface, but also the spreading of the virus will not be, continued. And the second one is to ensure the survival of the workers, bus operators and drivers. I mean, this is very, very difficult for us. Like the system, the current system basically employs 17,000 workers, as bus driver, And this bus driver is not only owned by us, well, I mean, hired by us. So we have, we do have our own bus drivers, but we also hire operators. So we contract out operators, and about 8,000 of the 17,000 people are employed by the operators. So, but during the pandemic, we have to stop their services, but because we have some contract already with them, even though the contract doesn't actually state that we have to pay them if the buses will not operate, but because of the, we don't want them to have loss of income and also, suffer. So we still have some kind of a minimum payment that we have to pay, at least to guarantee that the salaries for the drivers, for the technicians and also the managers, they're basically paid, even though the buses are not running. So that's basically just to make sure that the survival mode of the system, can be carried out. And the next phase, which is the sort of the midterm, then this basically, I think this is in line with Nupur's statement before, employing the IT-based operation to make sure there's an efficiency, like we don't need, we don't require people actually on the ground. And cash flow is something that we are also struggling with because of the loss of revenue. We have to make sure, right now, cash is king. So we have to make sure we have enough cash to, pay salaries and also pay all the operators and everything. Now, the long term, again, in line with the recommendation, I think, made by the previous presenters, like we have to reinvent the business model. I mean, the revenue stream right now, where we 65% of our revenue relies from the subsidy, has to change. So now we're basically working with the government. How can we be more sustainable, getting more sort of non-farebox revenues, be it from the advertisement and everything. And also digital transformation and new services. I mean, I think there are so many uncharted areas that we can really go into. And this in the past hasn't really been taken care of, because we're still focusing on serving the passengers, providing the public services. But right now, the idea is to make sure our business has kind of like expanded and, basically in short, like getting more money, more sustainable way. And that's pretty much the brief explanation on what's going on in Jakarta and Transjakarta and the current plan for us. Thank you, Dr. Singh.
Thank you, Mr. Yoga. I think that was really great. It gave us quite an understanding how, for example, you are meeting your I think your midterm and long-term plans, as a matter of fact, hopefully shall bring the, organization, the Transjakarta itself to a pre-COVID level as soon as possible. But these are very times where, as a matter of fact, a lot of support from the government is needed. And it is also where you need a lot of collaboration and partnerships from all other stakeholders to come out of this situation. Thank you so much. It's very revealing. There are quite a few questions which stand in your name, basically, I can see. But we will be sharing those questions with you with the request that you can kindly help us answering them so that we can share with all other participants and attendees for this. I think we will be sharing those actually through email subsequently, but we will certainly be taking up a couple of questions, although we are very, very late, running second hour of the, and we have the last speaker, one of the most important ones. Why I say most important? Because he represents the private sector, the, Boki, as we call it, Boki is the Bus Operators Confederation of India, which represents 90% of the buses in the country. 90%. They run almost like 1.5 million buses. They, as a matter of fact, have 6 million staff. That means 6 million families are dependent on that sector in a very big way. Mr. Navsharan Singh Garcha, he is a computer engineer by profession from Canada. He is the managing director of Kanker Roadways, which is a 50-year-old company operating in 6 states of India. He is also the state chairman of Bus Operators Confederation of India, Chhatisgarh. I invite him to share his views regarding the challenges being faced by the industry in the region of his operations as well as at a national level.
Good afternoon, everybody. I hope everybody can hear me, Mr. Singh.
Yes, thank you. Please,
we can. So first of all, thank you for the introduction. I feel very lucky to be in such distinguished company. I think it's been a long time, so we'll dive into it right away. Sonam, can we have the next slide, please? The major issue that we are facing right now is the lack of demand in our buses. I think the way forward to combat this is maybe not operate at 50% levels, but maybe only operate 30 to 50% of buses to begin with. For this, all the operators all around the country, we have to talk to each other. We have to reach a common ground. And maybe we can also talk to the aggregators who have our data, who have been operating buses for in the pre-COVID era, and realize who was operating how much. And maybe only to begin with, in the first phase, start opening 50%, then 60%, then maybe if things starts to look up, maybe by the end, we can go to 100% eventually. But jumping on to 100% right away is not going to help anybody else. We are hardly meeting costs, and I think that'll be catastrophic. The other big issue that many of us are facing is our drivers, our conductors, the labor that used to work for us. Most of them are back in their villages. They are maternal, paternal homes. And the big reason for this and why it will be very hard for us to get them back is what happened to them at the beginning of the pandemic. They were left high and dry, to tell you the truth. I mean, I know all operations stopped, but many of the manufacturing sector, even the transport sector and all the private businesses, they could only support their labor for maybe the first week, maybe the first month. But after that, they were left to fend for themselves. So nobody has the labor. They don't have the confidence to come back to work. What if something like this happens again? WHO has already suggested that we can expect a resurgence, a similar event very soon, maybe in the next year, maybe the next 6 months. What happens then? So would it make sense for them to stay home, or would it make sense for us to come up with some kind of SOP or some kind of action plan that we can tell them that in this case, that we can follow this, we can keep them safe, maybe if something like this happens again, we can get them home safely. So unless that is communicated to the people who are workforce, I don't think they would be coming back anytime soon. They may be working from where they are, but if you have drivers working from hide from UP or Bihar or like not your home state, then I think we'd have to give them some confidence for them to be able to come back to work for us again. Next slide, please. Sona, next slide.
Kindly move on. Next slide.
Yeah. So, no, the previous one, please. Previous slide. There you go. Fixed cost is something that we are concerned about. The one after this. The fixed cost is something that we are concerned about right now. I mean, all over the country, a major fixed cost while the buses are standing, apart from the capital cost, apart from salaries, is the motor vehicle tax. We have been asking the government to give us a break on motor vehicle taxes, at least for the time that is standing, and also 6 months after we begin operation, because everybody knows that operations are going to begin in a staggered manner. Everything is not going to go back to the same levels as it was pre-COVID. So we have been asking for breaks on motor vehicle taxes, but unfortunately the government have not been very responsive. As a result of it, many states, many private operators in, I can list off the top of my head, four states, Gujarat, Rajasthan, Himachal, Madhya Pradesh, they're already gone in to strike. They have refused to operate buses because we simply do not have the funds to do it. So unless the government comes forward and realizes that we need a break to start operations and we need their support to sustain operations for the months to come until we get back on our feet, I don't think anything happening. Another fixed cost, that a major cost, is insurance. So before operations start, many of the buses, many of the vehicles, they will be, the insurance might have expired, or the insurance cost that's based on how many kilometers we travel. The insurance cost is based on the risk that the buses are plying on the roads. But for the past 2 months, or almost 2.5-3 months, until we start operations, the buses have been standing. They have been standing still. So the risk of a standing bus cannot be the same as the risk of a bus operating 1,000 kilometers on the road. The insurance companies, the government has to step in, IRDA has to realize this, and they have to give us a extension. Maybe not 100%, but some logical number that we can work with. I mean, they have to come meet us halfway. So I hope the government is listening, and maybe we can work something out in the future. Next slide, please.
Nikita, next slide.
Stage carriage. No, the one before that, please. Stage carriage operations, they are the backbone of our country. Most of the stage carriage operations are taken care of by the government, but there are many regions where this responsibility falls on the private operators and the private sector buses. If you look at the picture on the left, this is mostly we're running buses in the interiors, where in the very remote villages, where this is the norm. If you go to Rajasthan, people are even traveling on top of the buses. So thinking of implementing social distancing norms or 50% occupancy norms just won't work. I think this has already been covered with the previous speakers, but I would just like to stress it again that this is not possible. The next thing is, even if you do implement social distancing, even if you do spray the buses with disinfectant, a stage carriage bus over a course of 300 kilometer journey will have at least 20 to 25 stops. How many times are you going to spray? Over a 500 kilometer journey, it will have 40 stops. So disinfecting the buses and putting masks on does not work. It does not show any concrete results. So maybe we have to think past it, and how can we operate this but still maintaining safety? What I think that right now it's not the time to start operations. The migration of the laborers across the country, it's almost migration of around 45 crore people, 450 million people who are working in the urban areas. They're coming from villages. The migration has been going on for the past 2 weeks. It's going to go on for another 10 days. After the migration is done, we have to identify the hotspots where the virus is showing up and where the virus isn't. And we start services between the districts where the virus is, it's a green zone or an orange zone, so to speak. I think everybody is aware of the terminology by now. So we only start services between these two places, but we cannot have 50% occupancy, social distancing. It does not work. Even if there is one even if you spray the bus 10 times, it only takes one COVID positive patient to enter the bus, and everybody sitting in the bus is just as good a risk as anybody else who has already gotten off the bus or before or after spraying. So you have to learn how to live with the virus, and we have to think smartly. We don't want to start too early. So like, we don't want to jump the gun. So it, the transport sector shuts down again, and maybe this time for a longer period of time. So we have waited so long, we are ready to wait for another 10 to 15 days. The government should take cognizance of this and allow all the transporters, the private operators, to stay shut for maybe another 15 days, take stock of the situation after, and then start operations. For us, I'm going to tell you about a regional issue for Chhatisgarh. 80% of population of Chhatisgarh is rural. It's the same as the case with many regions across the country. 90% of our customers are tribals or people from villages. Trying to explain to them the concept of social distancing and sanitizing is a very hard task, and it's not going to be done very quickly. So as I said earlier, the better and the easier and the safer thing to do would be to stop operations for another 15 days, see how the virus is growing, and then maybe start operations between the safe zones. Next slide, please. Another concern for our industry is the migration of people back from tier one cities to tier two and tier three cities. Most of our operation, or many of our high-end luxury buses, are operating to big cities like Bangalore, Mumbai, Pune, Hyderabad. They're like the tech capital or the finance capital. But as more and more companies go towards work at home culture, they want to save on land costs, they want to save on utility costs, and most probably and most importantly, they will be trying to save on travel allowances. So where does that leave us? All our luxury buses, all the high-end buses, where are they going to go? So I mean, we have to start thinking about those areas. I don't see that happening in the next, at least till the vaccine is out, in the next 3 months, in the next 4 months. So we have to think about how the people who were operating in those areas, what we are going to do, what lies ahead of us, what kind of help should we ask from the government, how do we readjust our businesses. Another thing that we have been using technology for quite a while now. Online ticketing has been around for a decade. We have so many algorithms to maximize profits, to attract the customers. But the technology has to be used to make travel safer for customers right now. So I urge all the aggregators, all the technology partners that are with the bus industry right now to come out with some technology that makes travel safer for us. So e-ticketing is there right now. But even after you book a ticket online, you either get a printout or you get a message on your phone. And that ticket stub, it could be in paper form or it could be an electronic form on your cell phone. That has to be handled by the driver or the conductor of the bus right now. So there is some exchange of your phone going to conductor, or the conductor handling these ticket stubs. There has to be a way that we make the whole thing contactless completely. I know there are a lot of IoT solutions that are going around in the world, and I urge all our technology partners maybe think about that and, you know, come out with a good solution for us. Next slide, please.
May I request you to kindly take 1 minute and conclude?
Yes, this is the last slide. So, yeah. So I've already talked about so many things that we expect from the government, be it motor vehicle taxes, be it insurance and other steps. And one more thing that we have been talking about with the government for such a long time is a scrappage policy. We understand in the year 2020, we are not expanding by any means. We barely want to hold on to what we have and maybe most of what we have right now. So a scrappage policy in this time where we get some kind of incentives from the government in ways of taxes that we can give our old buses. It's just like a trade-in that has not happened in the commercial vehicle sector till date. I would like the OEMs to think about it. I like the government to think about it. At least, that would help not increasing the fleet, but maybe, you know, making our fleet younger. So such policies should be thought about by OEMs and also thought about by the government. And that I think this would go a long way in the year to come in tackling 2020 and all the problems that we're having right now. In terms of OEM, I would like you to request that please provide us with cheap, sustainable, and reliable transportation options. I mean, splurging on luxury and comfort that is not needed for, absolutely needed for health, comfort, and safety should be avoided for the time being. We want you to help us, and we will also keep on helping the OEMs. I know we have to improve our fleet, but we need cheaper options right now. So just, Mr. Singh, this is where I conclude. I think I've gone through the whole presentation in a very fast forward kind of manner because I know we're running out of time. But I think if we keep the communication lines open, we can come through, we can make it. Thank you.
No, thank you very much. I think your message in terms of, sustainable and reliable options, which are very affordable, is something which is the need of the hour. And let me also mention that government has been talking about the scrappage policy, which is actually likely to be available very shortly because both Niti Aayog and the concerned ministries are working on it, and the first draft is nearly ready. And we do hope that scrappage policy will also help in generating the new demand, particularly for the OEMs, and you will have much better options where you are also able to use better technology, which as a matter of fact helps meeting the challenge also of COVID-19. But thank you so much. I think I do see there are almost like 46 questions, and I do not think that we have really time to take up the questions. I would say that disappointing all the participants and viewers that we have not taken up the questions and answers per se, but I can assure them that all these questions we shall certainly be taking up with all the panelists, requesting them that they should respond to specific questions which they are addressed to them. And with that, as a matter of fact, we'd like to circulate that these presentations will be made available on Busworld's website, say in another 2 days' time. And along with that, perhaps I think a day later, perhaps on the Busworld's website, you will also find all the answers to the questions which you have really taken. I take this opportunity thanking all the distinguished panelists. I would say we were thankful to Mr. Mohanty from UNCRD, Mr. Shivayogi from KSRTC, Mr. Suresh from Volvo, Nupur from World Bank, and I would say Mr. Yoga, my old friend from Transjakarta, and then Mr. Navsharan Singh Garcha, from representing Boki, as well as his own organization called Kanker, Roadways. Very nice, and thank you so much. We do hope to see you. Our next webinar will be on 18th of June, same time, but we will be announcing and sharing more details with the new topics and with the new panelists coming forward. And we are going to have this series of webinars till we reach our, you know, conference in October, from 6 to 8 October in Bengaluru. Physically, we will meet there. Thank you so much and highly appreciate it. I'll also like to thank my partners, Messe Frankfurt, for facilitating this entire webinar. I do regret for the doubling of my time. Practically, you know, it's we planned for 1 hour, but it has gone more than 2 hours. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you very much.